Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am V.N. Prabhakar from Archaeological Survey of India. In this paper on principles and methods of archaeology, we will be discussing upon the scientific tools in archaeological exploration. So we will be looking into what kind of scientific tools can be used for archaeological exploration. So we have various kind of tools that can be applied. They are very good in understanding the archaeological sites, because traditional techniques, they have certain kind of limitations, but with the application of sciences, we can really understand the archaeological sites in a better manner. So looking into the slides, we will come to know what kind of tools can be used. So these scientific tools are helping in faster and getting a wider picture, and we have two parts of scientific tools in archaeological exploration. In this first part, we will discuss on the aerial survey, remote sensing survey, and geographical information system. So what is an aerial survey? We are discussing about remote sensing also and aerial also. So I have clearly demarcated aerial survey from remote sensing survey here. Aerial survey, anything happening with the aid of a low flying aeroplane or any other object, while a remote sensing survey, it is with the aid of a satellite that is beyond the atmospheric region of the earth. So these kind of aerial surveys, the application of the aerial surveys, it also happened accidentally. It was during the World War I when the aeroplanes were being used extensively, the application came into picture. And also the military reconnaissance of locating various sites, they helped in understanding the applicability of this technique. So the pioneer in this technique is O.G.S. Crawford in England, Antoine Poidapot in Syria, and Eric Schmidt in Iran. So these people, they were initially understanding the terrain seen from the high altitude and how they can give various aspects of the landscape. So the principle of near vertical oblique angle photographs from aircraft in different light conditions, because in different light conditions the shadows are produced differently. In the morning the shadows are longer, in the noon period the shadows are very shorter. So the various features can be highlighted with this kind of different line conditions, light conditions, and they will help in locate the document and archaeological features. So here we can also understand two processes of photography from the aeroplanes or the low flying objects. So they are selective and non-selective. So these are the two processes of photography. Selective process consists of oblique photography, normally taken from handheld camera. What is oblique? I mean, when there is a flying object, the angle of photography may be the 45 degrees obliquely. It's not directly on the top. It's a oblique photography, so that's why it is known as a oblique photography. It can be taken with the help of any handheld camera also. Non-selective process involves in the taking of the vertical photography, that is perpendicular to the flying object, top view we are getting. So we have different applications. So you can see examples of oblique photography and vertical photography. On the left hand side we have the oblique photography, and the right hand side we have the vertical photography. On the vertical photography, very easily we can draw plans. Here some excavated remains are there. We can very easily draw the plans, the squares and rectangles, they can be very easily understood. From the oblique photography, we can very well understand the landscape here, how the archaeological mound is elevated from the surrounding plains. There is a darker area that may be the moat or a ditch. So this kind of broad based understanding can be understood from the two type of photography. Again, this is an illustration of how the cameras are fitted. Vertical photography, it is fitted perpendicular to the flying object and it takes the top view, and the oblique photography, it gets a sideways view of the terrain. So this kind of understandings can be done with the help of a thing. This kind of photography can be taken using the flying object. So what are the advantages of the oblique photography? It can be taken with the aid of cameras, mounted at certain angles to the surface. So what kind of features can be identified? It can identify ditches, fortification, mound formations, as you have seen in the image, how a oblique photograph can reveal various kind of features, and it can be carried out throughout the day to have better angles of lighting condition, because we have to take the photograph in the morning, in the noon and the evening of the same region, same area, to understand the different light for light conditions, shadows, and then the other features can be identified. And it also helps in having better pictorial view of the features. Very good understanding can be obtained through this kind of oblique photography. Other advantages of the oblique photography is that we can have a better perspective of the surface and highlight the archaeological features in a better manner. So we can understand in relation to the overall terrain how the archaeological features are there. We can also take photographs of known sites, and with the oblique views we can understand really the how the fortification is extending, if there is any gate or the fortification or not, how the moats are located, and all these things can be understood. So these things can also be analyzed in relation to survey or surface feature for better understanding and interpretation. So these things can be really used for understanding even unknown regions wherever ancient sites might have been located, and help in understanding the sites in relation to the terrain. So other aspect which I have told you earlier is the vertical photography. It is taken with cameras mounted perpendicular, as I explained before. So it will give a plan feature of the archaeological remains. It also helps in understanding partly buried structures and archaeological remains, which I will explain slightly later on. So how this vertical photography also helps in understanding the partly buried structures. It also helps in understanding the plan of exposed structures, as I showed in the photograph, how an excavated features can be very well understood, the plan can be drawn, and it can be used for documenting these features in a very better manner. So another advantage of the vertical photography is that it can be used for taking stereoscopic vision. What is stereoscopic vision? We take images with at least 60% overlap. We go on taking photographs of a plan feature with 60% overlap, then combine together. So it will give a stereoscopic vision even for obtaining measurable photographs. We can ultimately have a measurable photograph, which is also known as a photogrammetry in the scientific parlance. So we can have, from the photographs, we can measure features, we can measure the walls, we can measure the ditches and everything, and have a very good understanding of the archaeological feature. So this kind of photography, if done from the low flying aircrafts or flying objects like hot air balloons, can be a very good documentation tool. And combined together, vertical and oblique photography, they can always help in a better understanding of the archaeological features. And there are other features emanating from this vertical and oblique photography which also helps in a better manner. They are known as the earthworks, soil marks and crop marks. So you are seeing certain illustrations on the right hand side. You can see how the shadow marks, they are obtained through the oblique photography, and the shadows, various angles of the shadows, it gives the relative height or depth of a certain feature. So if there is a fortification wall, it will give a very long shadow. If there is a ditch side, by the side of the fortification wall, you will see the dark space. So these kind of things can be identified. And one more feature is the soil marks. So in the next slide, we will see one by one what is an earthwork, what is a soil mark, and what is a crop mark. So in the earthwork, what we can understand with the help of the shadow mark, as I told you, we can understand very large features like the ditches, fortification, and the entire archaeological site itself. Because if there is an entire archaeological site, if there is a moat around, so it will give a very clear indication of the shadows. It clear indication of where the fortifications are there, where the gates are there, and where the moat is also there. So this gives a slight rising above the surrounding plains, and it is detected by this technique. And also large earthworks, if they are man-made, like a large burial mound is there, like in the case of a Peruvian region or the Chinese region, there are very large pile of earthwork above a tomb. So these kind of earthworks can be clearly understood. So it can be also identifiable with a suitable height which not otherwise visible from the surface, because if we go on the surface, certain features cannot be identifiable, but from a certain height these features come out very clearly, and then the ground survey can be carried out to confirm these features. The shadow max also depend upon the period of time in which the photographs are taken. As I told you, in the mornings the shadows are lengthier, in the daytime the shadows are very short. So we have to combine all these images from the morning and the daytime and in the evenings to obtain the surface contours more sharply, because surface contours, it can be more easily understood during the morning and the evening lights. The earthworks may also be revealed to differentiation of vegetation on the surface, because there will be a variable height of vegetation which is clearly understood in the soil marks or the crop marks, which I will deal later on. So from these earthworks we can clearly understood what is happening, what is buried beneath the surface also can be detected from the this kind of aerial images. So the next comes the soil marks. It is also a continuation of the shadow marks, but the soil marks, they are very distinct surface features. They are very clearly visible on barren land. If there is a barren land not under cultivation, it can be viewed very easily, because if there is a cultivation there or agriculture activity is going on there, some features may be mixed together, but it is not under cultivation, some come out very prominently. The plowing activities, what happen if there is a plowing activity is happening, so they are mixing up the earth up and down. So they are bringing up the archaeological remains from the buried context and making it available on the surface. So different composition of archaeological remains, it comes to the surface and mixed with the surface soil and gives a different picture. So they when they are photographed, it gives a color indication. Certain areas they may be darker, some may be lighter. So if there are alignments seen on these things, so it can be clearly understood that it is due to the man-made structure. So it is clearly identified from the air through photographs, and it is also observed that the difference in retention of moisture, because certain features they absorb moisture more, some may absorb very less moisture. So this differential pattern, it is again visible from a certain height, not from the ground. So these kind of features are very much helpful in understanding if there is any buried archaeological remain also. The ultimate tool or ultimate understanding is the crop mark. So imagine an agricultural field, there is a buried archaeological remain, imagine a wall buried beneath, and there is a moat buried beneath. So what happened, there will be a positive growth of crop over a moat or a ditch or a shallow pit, and there will be a negative crop growth in the above the structures. Because if there is a stone wall buried, there will be very less growth above the stone wall. So this kind of differential crop growth can be very easily identified from the aerial photographs and can be correlated with certain buried features. So if we analyze large areas containing this kind of crop marks, we can very easily identify. Even a huge city can be identified, even the large ditch area or moat area can be identified by the presence of stunted or overgrowth vegetation. As I told you, the ditches or the shallow areas or the pits, they have fully overgrown vegetation, and the buried structures like stone walls, brick walls, they lead to stunted growth. So from these photographs, aerial photographs, we can clearly understand what kind of vegetation is there and what is the relative height of that. And if we combine with a photograph from multiple seasons and the years, because if we do this exercise over and over and again and combine together photographs from various seasons, it will give a very good understanding of the buried remains, and ultimately this can lead to surface investigation, and we can go to the field and understand very good understanding. Some of the examples I would like to cite here. So the aerial photography, sometime it is also helpful in monitoring activities near the archaeological site. So I will be showing two examples. This one is from of the Tughlakabad fort in Delhi. The left one is taken 1945 from an aeroplane, and the right one is from the Google Earth. You can see how the modern Tughlakabad village, it is completely occupying the entire archaeological remain completely. I mean, in a gap of nearly 70 years, totally they have occupied the entire ancient fort remains. So this is one aspect that can be very clearly understand if one want to really understand which one came earlier, which one came later, when this encroachment happened. So this can be clearly understood. The next one is from Shishupalgarh again. You can see the left one is taken in 1948 when the excavation was being carried out by B.B. Lal of the Archaeological Survey of India, when the entire mound was devoid of any kind of encroachment. Only a small village was located inside the fortified area. And the right hand side, you can see the thick and the very clustered encroachment happening, and the houses are located all around. So these kind of tools, not only it can be used for exploration, it can also be used for heritage management also. The Google Earth, it is very helpful because nowadays Google Earth has a time scale maps. I mean, we can go back in time also and see what was the terrain, what was the place in during the particular point of a year. So we have a time scale also, so we can compare various images and to understand the features. So some of the case studies here is one is by Tilok Thakuria, published in 2013. He used the Google Earth as a tool to locate archaeological sites that are not visible from the ground. So he used the Google Earth imagery. Then he went to the site and located and found some sites also. Like, he understood the nature of construction of a site known as Talpada, but a new archaeological site known as Lathi was discovered using Google Earth. So this is a very good tool also, and it is an open source tool. Anybody can use it in their computer and go and see various features. And again, Google Earth combined with GIS, it can also use for predictive modeling. I mean, people have attempted using predicting modeling of understanding various features, present day features, and they can use for locating what could be the areas from where these kind of features can be found. In the example of Gillespie, which I have quoted here, an article of 2016, how the Ashokan rock edicts, they were predicted. More number of sites have been predicted based on the GIS predictive modeling. So it's based on one algorithm, but one can use these features also. Just to introduce, I am telling all these things, but if you go on reading much literature, one can really understand. One more technique is known as the aerial reconnaissance, is the LIDAR technique. LIDAR is light detection and ranging. It works on a principle of emitting pulses. It hits the ground and it is coming back, this radar pulses, and that is measured and that is documented, and it creates a image known as point cloud image. So from that we can clearly understand what is the landscape. Very, very big landscape can be surveyed within a very short span of time. Maybe 50 square kilometer, 100 square kilometer can be covered within 1 hour or 1.5 hour. So the entire thing is scanned. Then that one is taken to the lab, then a computer and modeling helps in understanding even the buried features. So recently the LIDAR technique was used to even discover sites in the Central American region. The Mayan sites have been discovered, and even in the Angkor Wat region also they have understood various kind of settlements. So the LIDAR is particularly very good, useful, because it is very accurate, it is very fast, and it is unaffected by the terrain. As I told you, even if there is a dense vegetation cover, if the lidar survey is carried on, we can remove the vegetation cover. There are techniques available. It's a three-dimensional data. We can remove the vegetation cover and we can only see the terrain which is really important to us. So this is done using an aeroplane, and they are done very effectively, and collected data can be analyzed, as I told you before, in a computer based software. We can remove all the unwanted data and reveal only the data which we want, and then the buried features can be understood. So this is one example of the lidar survey, how the lidar equipment is mounted on an aircraft, and an entire terrain can be scanned, perfectly scanned, and it creates a three-dimensional data, and it can be taken to a computer, and processing can be done, remove all the unwanted features like the vegetation and all, then the minute surface features can be understood. The precision of this data is 5 to 20 centimeters. So it's very, very precise in terms of survey, and it's a very short period of time. So this kind of survey can be done. So it can cover very vast areas within a very short period of time. So, and it is also geo-reference. Geo-reference means it is like everybody understand GPS, because nowadays in your mobile also you have the GPS system is there, so you know the position. So this point cloud, each and every pulse it is hitting on the ground, that can be geo-referenced, and from that we can create a overall map superimposing on a satellite imagery, because we have satellite imageries which is also geo-referenced. So the entire imagery produced using lidar can be fixed on a geo-reference scale, and we can understand the vegetation pattern, we can understand the terrain, we can understand the various drainage patterns, and all this can be classified and understood. So there are various important case studies which I told you before. Also, we have excellent examples from Angkor Wat done very recently, and from the Mayan site of Caracol in Belize. So we have this kind of examples available, particularly in the Cambodian region. The lidar survey under the Khmer Archaeology Lidar Consortium, it was carried out in an area of 370 square kilometers. You can see it's a very huge area. So it was carried out in a short period of time, and it was also combined in such a period that there was the shedding of deciduous forest, because there's a thick rainforest is there. When the shedding is happening, there is less leaf cover, so the terrain can be better obtained, and during the dry season the terrain can be better mapped. So they adopted again different strategies. It's not important what kind of technique you are adopting. It is very important what kind of strategy you are adopting in using a certain technique. So they have adopted this technique of using this lidar during the dry season and during the shedding of deciduous forest, so that maximum coverage can be obtained and minimum intervention from the natural and man-made causes can be there. So this technique was very useful, and they could generate incredibly detailed and informative archaeological maps from this lidar survey for the understanding of socio-ecological dynamics over large scales. So this is a very useful technique if you are going to survey a very large area. Again, in the case of Belize, it is a 200 square kilometer area. It was surveyed, and this helped in understanding not only the topography but also structures, causeways, and natural terraces, because it records each and every small undulation. So if it is man-made, if there is a structure is man-made, it will be appear linear. If there is a causeway, it is appear linear, and all the terrace formations can be very easily understood, because the contour can be developed with the help of this documentation. So this is a very effective tool for a very large area. So this can be a really helpful in understanding the very large landscapes. We come next to the remote sensing. We have seen aerial survey. It is also one sort of remote survey, but here I am dealing separately in the remote sensing survey, because I am classifying this remote sensing surveys taken from the satellites. So it is also one top, sort of aerial photography, one can say, but it is done very remotely or from a very remote distance. So that's why I'm classifying them, because it has it is taken from the satellite imageries, and it also have their own disadvantages in detecting subsurface features, but they have certain advantages also. So if the satellite imageries they are taken using various kind of sensors, it can give very good understanding of the surface features also. So the remote sensing survey, it uses various kind of radiation, prominently the electromagnetic radiation in the visible, near infrared, short infrared and thermal infrared. There are various radiation depending upon the wavelengths. So they are classified into infrared and thermal infrared and various other things. So if the electromagnetic radiation in these regions they are used, they are suitable for detecting the surface anomalies, and if it is correlated with the surface, subsoil surface. So these things they are really helpful, and they work on the principle of detection and measurement of electromagnetic radiation reflected from the surface of objects, because certain objects, it has a different, due to their properties, it radiates in a different manner. So this can be detected with the help of a proper detector, and that can be analyzed. So the infrared images are very particularly useful in this kind of remote sensing surveys, and we have various imageries already available, satellite imageries already available. And it is, if you visit the site which I have mentioned here, earthexplorer.usgs.gov, it gives various kind of remote sensing images coming from aerial imagery, commercial satellites like Iconos, RBU, Spot. There are digital elevation models. So the whole range of remote sensing maps are available from this site. And the most important tool is the Shuttle Radar Topography Mission, which can be used for various kind of investigations. So even the Landsat and the ISRO imageries are also available. The commercial satellites like the QuickBird, they are also available. So these things can be downloadable if you mention the latitude and longitude, and that can be used for various kind of preparing thematic maps. Also you can use these maps for producing waterways, forest areas, urban areas, agricultural land, pasture. So these images can be used for classification of the land area. I mean, you can use various GIS softwares for them, and also to understand their correlation in the overall landscape pattern. So these things can be very useful in understanding the religious patterns and the human ecology also. So the kind of plans what we use and how we monitor and how we kind of classify them helps in understanding locating the various archaeological sites. So we can detect buried river channels also. We can also locate the dry beds also, and also the sites can be visualized how it could have been located on this terrain. So this is one sort of application of the remote sensing survey, where we can classify and prepare various kind of thematic maps depending upon the various categories what we desired. Now I will discuss certain case studies using the remote sensing survey. This is one case study using a satellite imagery, how the dry bed of River Saraswati has been delineated. You can see the arrows indicating the dry river bed of Saraswati, and this thing has been done by various geologists and scientists like Valdia, Ghosh et al., Gupta et al., and these people, they have used the various categories of the satellite imageries, and they have delineated the course of the river, and during various part of the time scale, from the 3rd millennium, from the 2nd millennium, because the river has been fluctuating and it has been changing courses, and so the various courses have also been understood. So using these kind of data, scholars like Rajini and Rajawat, they have used this data to create a digital terrain modeling of the entire river course, and they have plotted the Harappan sites all along the river course, what they have already obtained from the various published sources, and they have tried to understand the relation between the river Saraswati and the Harappan sites, and also the various terrains, because if a digital elevation model is created, we can understand the relative heights of the river course and also the banks on the both sides. So we can understand where the sites are located and certain elevation they are located. So this kind of minute details can be understood. So also one more example is from the site of Nalanda, where Rajini, she has used Google Earth as well as the satellite imageries to identify natural and archaeological features. So here in this example, she has shown various kind of settlements like water bodies, archaeological features, buried temples, maybe looking into the present day condition also, and looking into the this kind of remote sensing images also, and identifying archaeological features, how it looks from the satellite imageries and Google Earth imageries, and also locating them on the surface, we can have a better understanding. This is a very good example of satellite remote sensing on a micro scale and site specific, because this smaller site has been selected here instead of the previous example which I shown, it's a very large area covering part of the subcontinent. Here a small site has been selected and it has been investigated. So next we discuss on the geographical information system, how it can be used for the archaeological exploration. So what is GIS? GIS is a very powerful set of tools for collecting, storing and retrieving at will, transforming and displaying spatial data from the real world for a particular set of purposes. So from the GIS, we can collect various data from different aspects, different fields, and then combine together and viewed in the form of a map, because it will be in a vector based format. So we can have various kind of information. For example, if I want to understand a particular site, I will superimpose various kind of maps. I will have older maps, new maps, topo sheets, then satellite imageries, and various kind of maps, and also photographs from the aerial survey, and combining them in a single window, and I will be using it for interpretation, predictive modeling. So the various kind of terrain information can be obtained, the population information can be obtained. So all this data can be combined together, and there are tools available in GIS software which can be used for creating interpretation data. So if the multiple maps they are created in a GIS environment, each layer corresponding to a specific information of properties are recorded. The attributes are recorded. That is the basic task. One has to first collect the basic tools and attributes, and that has to be recorded in each and every specific area. For example, if a particular study area is kept as constant, we can go on collecting the drainage pattern of the area, geology of the area, soil pattern, rainfall, temperature corresponding to that area. And in this each separate layer, we go on feeding what is the kind of information, and we have also satellite imageries now fed with all kind of data. And if they are superimposed, then we can simply switch on and off this particular layer and really understand what kind of terrain the sites are located. If we can even analyze the terrain in terms of particular sites and see in which period of the cultural period what kind of sites are located. So the information corresponding to a particular layer can be easily visible and understandable. So that is the clear understanding of a geographical information system. For this we need to have a GIS software. GIS software, open source software is also available in the case of GIS. There are many GIS software available, and even license software is also available. So with this thing, we can also do various kind of analysis. We can also input data to understand what could be the sea level in the ancient period. If we can also predict if there is a 1 meter rise in sea level, what kind of sites would be kind of submerged. If there is a 2 meter rise in sea level, how many sites would be submerged. So this kind of predictions can also be done, simulations can also be done, and we can understand the ancient coastlines also with the help of GIS. So it's a basically analytical and interpretative tool using a statistic methods. We can also do the site settlement pattern, like we can plot all the sites. For example, in the case of a Harappan civilization, we can have basic information, latitude, longitude of the Harappan sites, and we can plot them on the GIS platform. We can see what is a major settlement, how many settlements are located all around, what is the relative distance in between them, what is the size of the settlement, ranging maybe an urban settlement or a town settlement or a village settlement. So what is the relative position of them, and all these kind of interpretations can be possible. We cannot go on measuring each and every site, but if we are plotting them in a GIS environment, the software does it automatically, and we can also create and understand core areas or peripheral areas and how the settlements are located. So this is also possible, and we can also understand various kind of analysis from this data fed into the computer. We can do a slope analysis from which is the elevated area, which is the low-lying area, and what is the drainage pattern. We can also create maps of drainage pattern of a particular area. We can also understand the terrain. We can also easily create the contours of an area, and all these things can be done automatically if we have a particular a remote sensing data is available. As I told you, in that USGS site, we have large number of satellite imageries available. If we have a suitable satellite imagery, we can do all kind of analysis and also do the watershed analysis, how a particular area can be submerged or not, how in during a particular period of time we can simulate and understand what is the submergence area, and all this kind of things can be done. And several scholars have worked on this GIS tool and predicted what could be the pattern of archaeological sites vis-a-vis the landscape and the terrain. One example is by Gore et al. Published in 2013. As I told you, they have predicted what could be the coastline if there is a rise in sea level. So they have predicted with a 3 meter rise in sea level of the Gujarat coast, where most of the Harappan settlements are there. So this data, they have correlated with the geological studies also, because there is a regular siltation of the runoff catch at an average rate of 2 millimeter per year. And so they conclude from the GIS studies that during 3rd millennium BC, the run was an extended gulf, and there was navigation even possible through this area. And this is supported by the early centuries of the current era, where the external traders, they were coming and they were navigating in this area. So this kind of studies, they are very well helpful in understanding the ancient topography, ancient coastline, and the location of the sites also. The present day sites, they may be very far away from the present day coastline, but if we do the simulation, we may understand that they might have located on the coast itself. So one more study which I touched upon briefly earlier is the predictive modeling to predict possible location of Ashokan inscriptions. We know there are Ashokan inscriptions located all over India. There are pillar inscriptions, there are rock inscriptions, and all those kind of things. Feeding all those data, that is around 121 location they are proposed. So based on the available locations, they have fed into the data, and also knowing the various kind of population and other data, climate data, rock terrain data. So with this, they have predicted that, look, we are getting so many Ashokan inscriptions in the present day context, depending on the various localities. So there is a possibility, based on these localities, there's a possibility of future more sites also. So they have predicted 121 possible locations. So that may not be ultimately true also, but there is a possibility. Like we can do a predictive modeling of feeding the present environmental condition, geographical conditions, and then extending it to an extent that maybe we can predict more sites. So in this aspect also, GIS software is very much useful, and they have also used various additional information in this by there is a data available of human induced global land use change over the past 12,000 years. There is one data available. There is a climatic and elevation data sets. They are available, and they also used entropy algorithm. There is a scientific mathematical calculation that is also available. So these are all already available in the GIS environment. So this can be incorporated to the basic remote sensing data and feeding all the climatic, topographic and geological data. So they were able to predict the possibility of future inscriptional location. So this is one such example where the GIS can be used. One is the coastline example I have told you. One is the using the present day data and predicting where could be the possible location of other inscriptions. So that is one possibility. So coming to the conclusion, we have seen various tools. In the first part of this scientific tools in archaeological exploration, we have seen the aerial survey, remote sensing survey and the GIS. So it helps in understanding a broader picture of the archaeological sites. It may not help in ultimately the giving the results of a ground-based survey, but we can have a broader based understanding. We can predict the coastlines. We can predict certain location of archaeological sites based on the present day data available, and we can also use these tools to interpret the sites, archaeological sites, like I showed you in the aerial survey of two sites, how we can use these kind of imageries for even documentation heritage structures and also heritage management to understand the sites in the proper context. So in the next module, we will be seeing about the second part of the scientific tools in archaeological explorations. You can also refer to other parts of this module to understand more about the references and the articles which have been I have quoted, and also to understand more about this module. Thank you.